So what now? We're done the script. Yeah, but we still need a parody. Like a movie spoof? Exactly. Remember all those Batman references we made for the biodiversity video? I got you. We need something popular. Something modern. How about The Social Network? It hasn't really got that epic science fiction feel that our Inception parody had. We've already started with that theme, we should probably keep it rolling.
Keep up rolling.
Sci-fi movie genre, we're brainstorming spoof ideas.
Sci-fi? Man, you've got to do Back to the Future.
Cadmium? Where we're going, we don't need cadmium. But Back to the Future has nothing to do with biology. It has to be more relevant than that.
Relevant? Like the Dark Knight relevant?
You're not helping.
Need any help?
Sure.
Great!
What with? Movie. Parody. Science fiction, but also real science, so no time travel.
Ah. Guess that rules out Star Trek then.
Why is it so bright? Oh, there's absolutely no reason for this many lights. Oh. Who designed this?
I think it's more the lens.
Yeah, more the science, the science, the reality, than the time travel.
I don't understand how this could be so hard. We need something space-oriented, with war and love and loss. Something fantastic. Something epic. It's got to be stunning.
Classic.
Representative of the greatest film franchise of all time.
Star Wars!
Take a look around you. How many other people are sharing your immediate surroundings? Unless you're watching this alone in your bedroom on a lonely weekend evening, which statistically speaking is the most likely scenario based on viewer analytics, you are sharing the room and building you're in with tens, hundreds, or even thousands of other people. What's more, you are currently part of a community, of a city, and of a country that may contain millions of people. Globally, you are part of the planet we call Earth that contains over 7 billion other members of the species Homo sapiens. These collective examples of our humanity are known as populations, and the dynamic fluidity of these populations represents one of the most fundamental notions of ecology. Nothing lasts forever. To begin our look at human population dynamics, we must first gain an understanding of the overarching life sciences field known as ecology. Ecology is the broadest study of life, taking into account the relationships between individual organisms, global populations, and abiotic factors that play into the maintenance and evolution of the world's ecosystems. The scope of this field of study is massive. Hierarchical ecology attempts to understand the scale of the living world, from genes and cells to entire biomes. Biodiversity describes the variation among species exhibited at different levels of biology. Today, however, we want to understand human ecology, which rests primarily upon the shoulders of populations. Population ecology has existed for a very long time. The term itself originated in Greece as autecology, a word stemming roughly from the Greek household and knowledge. Autecology studied the relationships between individual species and their environments, though today most ecologists are more concerned with the study of individual populations than entire species. Modern population ecology is a combination of biological theories, demography, and statistics, with population dynamics remaining possibly the most well-known and useful of its subfields. Environmental processes influence the carrying capacity and biological potential of any given ecosystem, while natural birth and death rates, along with immigration and emigration, play their own part in affecting how many of a species, and indeed how many different species in total, can live comfortably and sustainably in a region. Population dynamics utilizes life sciences theories and mathematical models to study and predict changes that occur within populations, and the reasons behind said fluctuations. So why is it important to know how groups of species change and interact? Why do we bother marking and recapturing thousands of sea turtles, hyraxes, and other animals just to build a graph outlining how their numbers are changing? As it turns out, population dynamics have far-reaching implications for countless other fields, including tourism, urban planning, and agriculture. We as humans also live in populations, and so the same theories and models that we apply to insects to track disease patterns can be applied to us.
Let's step this back a bit. The year is 8,000 BCE and human beings are just figuring out how to make their own food. Now, at around this point in history, humanity saw the rise of the Neolithic Revolution, a cultural and agricultural breakthrough that brought with it new advances in farming, and more significantly, farming. Agriculture allowed people to begin settling down and forming permanent communities, because they were no longer forced to follow their food as it moved. Instead, the food just grew in their backyard. A reliable source of sustenance, one of the first indicators of civilization, helped the once measly human population of maybe 5 million to skyrocket to over 170 million by the turn of the Common Era. From here, Homo sapiens was destined to become a world power. It took about 1800 years for those several million to become 1 billion, and about another 125 years for that one to become a two. Over the course of the 20th century, the world population has tripled to about 6 billion, and currently stands at a little over 7. Clearly, this growth is incredible. People make up the largest population of any large mammal on Earth, and that isn't about to change anytime soon. Predictions place our hitting the 8 billion mark sometime before 2030, and who knows where we could go from there. There's still a big question we need to answer, though. How did we manage to fit all of these people on just one planet? Well, for one, we didn't stop advancing agriculture in the Neolithic period. New technologies continued being developed right up until the 1700s, at which time people began industrializing just about everything that manual labor had previously been responsible for. Mechanized farming permitted humans to grow huge amounts of food, much more than nature would have allowed, and so upped our carrying capacity by removing limiting factors. Other limits, such as our susceptibility to disease and our living proximity to our own waste, were largely remedied by advances such as modern medicine and sewage. Since the Industrial Revolution, the Earth's carrying capacity has seemed somewhat limitless, because we keep increasing our population, and there haven't seemed to have been any repercussions. Or have there? As it turns out, we haven't completely removed all of our species' limiting factors. Food is still a relatively scarce resource in many parts of the world, meaning we cannot feed everybody we need to. Again, our planet currently supports, or is trying to support, about 7 billion people. But from what we know of average human nutrient requirements and preferences, the world's combined food output can only support 11 billion people. Wait, what? The amount of resources we produce varies somewhat from the amount we consume. In the case of the world food supply, much of the food our industries grow is in turn fed to other food. Feeding the world's pigs and cows to supply us with meat and dairy products puts a tremendous amount of strain on our ability to feed actual people. It's not just food that we're putting towards questionable uses, however. Our freshwater supply is also a limiting factor when it comes to population growth. And in the United States, most of that is used to irrigate grass. So while we're giving all of our food to chickens and all of our water to golf courses, the human population continues to grow at a rate of about 1.1% every year. So why is this? Of course, healthcare and general standards of living are only getting better, so it should come as no surprise that most people are living longer lives. The average life expectancy in 1890 was around 45, while today most people are living to be well over 65 years old. But this isn't the only reason that the number of human beings is getting larger. Here's where population dynamics can lend us a hand. A study of the world's population shows the surprisingly uneven distribution of the 7 billion people currently living on Earth. Larger pockets of humans, such as cities and other industrialized areas, are often surrounded by areas of low population density, such as farmland or even forest. This pattern of distribution is called clumped distribution, but on a world scale, it has led to the formation of large, populated regions in some rather imperfect places. These regions are usually comprised of or make up the part of the world that we classify as developing. The people living here have limited access to food, clean water, energy, healthcare, and other services that we in the developed world often take for granted. Now, despite the lack of resources in a country like Mauritania, for example, the women there tend to have 5, 6, or even 7 children, in stark contrast to the 2 or 3 most Western women have. There are a variety of reasons for this, including the necessity most families in places like Tanzania have for extra laborers, and the unfortunately high infant mortality rates most developing countries experience.
The difference now is that modern medicine and Western advances in life expectancy are finding their ways to sub-Saharan Africa and Southeast Asia, meaning all of those extra babies aren't dying as often, which is a good thing. The only repercussions of this general improvement in the quality of life is that the populations of countries still boasting high fertility rates are rapidly rising. Families that used to birth 6 babies and only successfully raise 2 of them are now seeing nearly all of them reach adulthood and start families of their own. Which, and I cannot stress this enough, is definitely great. But many of these families are not prepared to feed that many mouths, and the so-called third world is already stressed enough in the population department. Approximately 85% of the world's population lives in nations not considered by the UN to be highly developed. This means that the areas experiencing the most population growth are also the ones already scrambling to support all of the people living within them. Collectively, the struggles mankind faces as a result of having so many people living in one world are part of an issue known as overpopulation. Now, some would argue that we have yet to reach our carrying capacity, but given the poverty and famine in the developing world, it's hard to say that we are doing enough to support the people that we already have. It's important for us to curb our own species' population growth for 2 reasons. One, there's already 7.12 million of us, so we're already in no danger of natural extinction anytime soon. Two, while our potential for growth seems limitless, many of our planet's resources are non-renewable, and humans may have to consider the possibility that some of their most beloved fuels and minerals may be about to run dry. How can we go about solving our population crisis? Again, population dynamics might be able to help us. Trends predicted by analytics derived from things like birth rates and immigration statistics might be able to tell us where on earth all of these people are coming from, as well as how long they might live, how many children they might produce, and how large an ecological footprint they might have on the earth. This information can help us predict how the populations of various regions may shift and evolve over the next 10, 50, and even 100 years, allowing mankind to formulate a comprehensive population management strategy. Solutions to the too many human beings problem range from the extreme to the overly simplistic. Short of just blowing up half the world, however, we do have legitimate and proven ways of combating overpopulation. Education has been positively linked to lower rates of population growth. Developed nations with better educated citizens typically have lower fertility rates than developing nations with less well-educated citizens. Government-sponsored family planning programs have also been successfully implemented in some places, and in India, these programs have more than halved fertility rates since the 1960s. In China, financial incentives have been made available to smaller families, and indeed, the entire country's tax structure favors couples with fewer children. Monetary motivation is a proven and useful way to promote slower population growth, but isn't practical in every scenario. Of course, not all of our problems on Earth have to be faced on Earth. The slightly less feasible, if all the more imaginative strategies outlining galactic colonization depict many futures in which humans have left their home planet to live comfortably among the stars. Whether it is a densely populated base on Mars or a spacefaring fleet traversing beyond the solar system, the concept does sound intriguing and offers an interesting alternative to remaining under a static, Earth-bound carrying capacity. Our options are limitless, but our ability to support every human being alive isn't. We may only have a few years left before our demand for food completely outstrips our supply, and our non-renewable resources are already in scarce quantities. Many of the people being born today are located in developing, impoverished nations, many of which are already experiencing overpopulation issues themselves. It seems that the answer to many of these problems lies in cultural changes, education, and planning, but it may be necessary for us to one day leave the nest and remove our planet's space as a limiting factor. And so, it's up to us, everybody alive on Earth right now, to determine the course of action our species must take to enter a more sustainable future. Homo sapiens is probably the single most influential species in the history of our planet, and we have the opportunity to keep it that way for the foreseeable future. It may require us to rethink our way of life, to reconsider the more destructive practices we commit in the name of progress. Our world can support us, but only if we are ready to suspend the reckless utilization of resources that has led our population to its current state. For humanity to advance, it must first be prepared to adapt. Are we up to the challenge? Well, from just one person's point of view, I think we are. What the other 7 billion of us think, however, well, that's a very different question. I'm Ryan Conrad, Thanks for watching.
Yo, Sidhu, so have you started your population summative yet?
Population, man, two jokes.
So, are you just not gonna do this one, man?
I don't know, man. What's your topic?
I don't remember. Maybe we should email her. Oh, no. It's the one about the trees.
Wait, I was gonna pick that topic.
Well, I mean, she'll just probably let you do it too. I mean, she doesn't really mind, right?
What?
What the hell, man? I paid for that.
Well, if you go back to McDonald's, I'm sure you can get another one. You dropped my McNuggets.
You have done that yourself.
You will not take them from me.
Your hunger and your lust for McNuggets have already done that. You have allowed these cardboard paltry substitutes to take over your mind. Until now, you are the very thing you swore to avoid.
Don't lecture me, Steven Zhu. I see through the lies of the John. I do not fear the sketchy side as you do. I brought trout, pandas, chromosomes, and McNuggets to my new empire.
Your new empire.
Don't make me beg you.
My allegiance is to the jam, to biology.
If you're not with me, then you're my enemy.
Only a 47 deals in absolutes. I will do what it must.
Come at me, bro. What happened to the lightsaber effect?
We ran out of money. It's over! I did the bonus assignment.
You underestimate my lab marks.
Don't try it. Ah.